Amen. Come on, let's give God some praise for our music ministry. We praise God for our music ministry. Praise God for Brother Westfield reminding us indeed that we can depend. Amen. We can depend on God no matter what we go through. We can always, always depend on God. And we praise the name of the Lord this day. For those that would be so willing, if you would turn with me to our scripture for today, second chapter of Acts, Acts the second chapter, verses 14 through 21, and then 41 through 47. Acts the second chapter, verses 14 through 21, and then 41 through 47. And I think I forgot to announce this. Bible study this week will be tomorrow, just for this week. It will be tomorrow, Monday at noon and 7 p.m. Bible study just for this week will be noon and 7 p.m. tomorrow. Please come on out. And if you would, for background and for understanding, if you would read Acts, the fifth and sixth chapters of the book of Acts for tomorrow's Bible study, noon and 7 p.m. We look forward to seeing everyone come out. Amen. 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 Acts, the second chapter, verses 14 through 21, and then 41 through 47, we find these words, the New Living Translation of the Bible. Then Peter stepped forward with 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd, "Listen carefully, all of you, fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem. Make no mistake about this. These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that. No, what you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Young men will see visions, old men will dream dreams. In those days I will pour out my spirit even on my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. I will cause wonders in the heavens above and the signs on the earth below, blood and fire, clouds of smoke. The sun will become dark, the moon will be blood red before that great and glorious day of the Lord arrives. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Jumping down to verse 41, Peter preached for a while. Bible says for a long time. In verse 41, those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day. About 3,000 in all. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. All the believers met together in one place. They shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple every day, meeting in homes for the Lord's Supper, sharing their meals together with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And every day, the Lord added to their fellowship the number being saved. For a few moments today, as we celebrate God together on this Sunday after Pentecost, I ask that we would consider this subject, the proof of the power. The proof of the power. For those of you that remember, past few weeks we've been dealing with the week before Pentecost, the day of Pentecost, and this week as well we've been dealing with the power of the Holy Spirit, Comforter, the Paraclete, the one that comes to give us sustenance and to guide us and lead us until the return of Christ Jesus. Holy Spirit was celebrated as being poured out on the world on the day of Pentecost, which was last week, and 2 weeks prior to today, we began talking about the Holy Spirit and the power that the Holy Spirit has, and we led off the week before Pentecost with the understanding of the power to become, what the Holy Spirit gives us the power to become, and the Holy Spirit gives us the power to become defenders of our faith, to become more trusting in God, and finally, to become transformed. Last week, we picked up again from the power to become, moving to the power to be. The study last week, we learned how the Holy Spirit gives us the power to be unified, the power to be filled and to release God's Spirit, and finally, the power to be amazed. And for the past couple of weeks, as we studied the power of the Holy Spirit, I think today it's only fitting, as we close out this Pentecost cycle, that we would understand the proof that's found in the power of the Holy Spirit. In our society, there is an overwhelming need we have to prove anything that's said to us. So if someone says something, we have the desire and the need to prove it because we're just not as trusting as maybe we ought to be. Give an example. If someone is arrested, there is supposed to be proof of the crime. There's an old saying that we say, if you've eaten or had anything, they say the way to tell if something is good, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. Therefore, if it's good and you taste it and it's good, then you know there's proof that it is indeed good. And in the Old Testament, the Bible says the test of a prophet rests in whether or not the prophet, what the prophet says comes true. So if what the prophet says comes true, the prophet is of God. If what the prophet says doesn't come true, the prophet's not of God. So even in the Old Testament, there had to be proof behind that which was said. And if there's anybody in here from the state of Missouri, the state of Missouri has even adopted as its motto the entire state. It's called the Show Me State. In other words, whatever you tell me, you got to show me, because I'm not going to believe you without proof. So for the past couple of weeks, I've been talking to you about the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. And God led me to this text and this understanding that he has proven to us everything that he said in his word. In the passage of scripture today, we look at some of the events that began on the day of Pentecost and took us past the day of Pentecost. We begin with Peter stepping up to preach on the day of Pentecost about salvation for everyone. He continues preaching. The Bible says he preaches for a long time. Folk probably got tired of hearing Peter preach. Peter preached for a long time. But when it was over, 3,000 people joined church that day and were saved. After this, the people, the Bible said, met together daily in worship, sharing everything they had, selling their possessions even to help somebody else in need. And the text concludes by saying God added daily to their number in the community of the persons who were being saved. For the past 2 weeks, we've talked about the power of the Holy Spirit, the power to become and the power to be. And today I want to give you proof of that power. Matter of fact, hopefully in this message today, you will also find proof of the Holy Spirit's power in your life. Not just in what happened in the Bible and not just in what we see on the day of Pentecost in the book of Acts, but I want you prayerfully to see the manifestation of the Holy Spirit's power working in your life as well. So three things God teaches us today to give us proof of his power. Here's the first. The power of the Holy Spirit, the proof is, the power of the Holy Spirit turned denial into deliverance. The proof of the Holy Spirit, the power turned denial into deliverance. We're gonna wake up a little bit. It's rainy outside. I think the rainy weather has taken us over in here, because y'all looking at me like y'all want to go home. I want to go home. Everybody want to go home. So we're going to have a little fun for a moment. Is there anyone in here, if you don't mind raising your hand and sharing today, that really can attest to the old saying? You don't have to raise your hand, but if you would like to, if you can attest to the old saying that says, I may not be what I want to be, but I praise God I ain't what I used to be. Is there anybody here like that? Amen. Amen. So we have a few people that might not be exactly where I want to be or what I want to be, but thank God I'm not what I used to be. And that is through and by the power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit brings us comfort, brings us peace, and brings us guidance. And the guidance of the Holy Spirit leads us to Jesus. Jesus leads us to salvation. So I follow the power of the Holy Spirit, which allows me not to be what I used to be. And as I follow the power of the Holy Spirit, I'm ultimately led to Jesus, where I shall be, like so many others, saved. That's the proof of the power. So in the text, it begins with Peter stepping forward to preach to the crowd. Peter comes out. The Bible said the 11 other apostles were with Peter, but Peter was the one that stepped forward. Everybody was together there, all 12, but Peter was the one that took the forefront, that took the soapbox, that took the stage, that took the pulpit, and Peter was the one that began to preach. Bible said Peter begins talking about how God told us about the day of Pentecost before the day of Pentecost, how Joel told us about it in his prophecy, and how this day was one that had been ordained by God, and young men dream dreams, old men will see vision, old men dream dreams, young men will see vision. Everybody who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Peter began to preach, and Peter preached with boldness. Peter preached with clarity. Peter preached with conviction, so much so the Bible says that 3,000 people that day were saved and began to follow Jesus. One thing I do know about the Bible and record keeping in those times, oftentimes when it was recorded, it was not the number of people, but usually they just recorded men. So there were probably 3,000 men that joined church that day, not counting the women and the children. So if you add the men, you add the women, you add the children, you've got thousands of people that gave themselves over and began to follow Jesus that day because Peter preached. And the part that gets me, this is one of my favorite stories in the Bible. I love this story. But what gets me about this is not the fact that Peter preached such a powerful message. What gets me today is not so much the message that was preached. What gets me is who was doing the preaching. It's amazing, not so much what Peter said, but what's amazing to me is it was Peter that got up and said it. Because the last time we really saw Peter, we saw Peter in a courtyard. Y'all remember that? And in that courtyard, there was a young girl who spotted Peter, and Peter was trying his best to distance himself from Jesus. No shame in saying that all of us at one time or another have done some things where we wanted to distance ourselves from Jesus. I ain't preaching to nobody but myself today, so if I have to give myself an amen, Reverend Cousin, thank you. I'm going to keep going. I'm going to give myself an amen. There have been things that we've all done in life that have caused us to want to distance ourselves from Jesus. So the last time we saw Peter, he was in a courtyard surrounded by and hanging out with the guards who would later arrest and try and crucify Jesus. So Peter is in the courtyard around the fire with these guards. A young girl sees him and says, he was with that man Jesus. Peter said, girl, you better shut up. She said again, she said, no, you were with Jesus. And Peter said, you better be quiet. And then somebody said, yeah, he looks like one of them Galileans. And Peter got up, I believe, he put his hand on his sword. You know Peter, he probably put his hand on his sword. He was getting ready to cut somebody's ear off and cut something off. He said, I don't know Jesus. I don't know anything about this man Jesus. Please do not associate me with this man Jesus. And then they arrested Jesus and the cock crowed and you know the rest of the story. That's the last time we saw Peter. So you've moved now from Easter to Pentecost, which as we talked about is about 50 days. 50 days is about what, 7 weeks? So in about 7 weeks, Peter has gone from somebody who didn't know Jesus to now somebody who gets out and speaks about Jesus and 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 people join church. Let me just stop right here for a minute. Don't you ever think that God cannot use you to do his will? Don't you ever think that God can't use you to achieve what God wants done? God took Peter, somebody who denied Jesus, and turned him from somebody who was in denial to somebody who led people to deliverance. One of the things I believe is I think some of us are shortchanging ourselves and shortchanging God and not fulfilling what God would have us to be because we're letting who we used to be impede who God wants us to be. Well, I stand here to let you know, don't you let anybody, including yourself, hold you back from what God wants you to be. God is able to take anybody. He did it with Peter. He did it with Saul, who became Paul. He did it with so many. He did it with Matthew. He did it with Zacchaeus. He did it with so many in the Bible where he took them from where they were and turned them around so they might be able to be used as instruments to proclaim the goodness of God, the proof and the power of the Holy Spirit. All you have to do is look in the mirror. Because I know some of us in here know we used to be something else. Come on now, church. You know, you look at yourself in the mirror and say, boy, I thank God I ain't that person anymore. That's a person I did not want to know, but that's the person I used to be. But by the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, he turns denial into deliverance. Second thing God does after he turns denial into deliverance, the power of the Holy Spirit brings about a change in a culture. He turns denial to deliverance and brings change in a culture. One of the things about the Holy Spirit that I love is the Holy Spirit has the ability not just to change one individual, but the ability to change an entire culture. One thing about me, I like to talk about oftentimes what I know, and I use a lot of sports metaphors. And love it or love him or hate him, like him or not, LeBron James has changed once again the culture of Cleveland basketball. He left Cleveland and they got mad, went back to Cleveland and they got happy. Left Cleveland and they lost millions and millions, I think it's in the hundreds of millions of dollars of revenue. LeBron goes back, money comes back. And what we find is LeBron comes in and changes the team
Because now, because of one player, pretty much same team, because of this one player, now they get other players who they wouldn't have gotten before. They get the J.R. Smiths. They get the Iman Shumpers. They get the Timothy Mozgov. They do all this stuff. LeBron, one old LeBron comes in, changes the culture of the team. So as the team's culture begins to change, then the culture of the community begins to change because folk bring the money back. And when people bring the money back, they see LeBron come in and they say, LeBron not just made Cleveland a winning basketball organization again, he made Cleveland a winning city again, all because one man went and changed the culture. Now, if one little LeBron James can do that, imagine the power that the Holy Spirit has to change an entire atmosphere. Because the Holy Spirit, when the Spirit comes in, the Spirit gets into each and every one of us. And as the Spirit begins to dwell in the bodies and the souls, in the hearts and minds of believers, and as we are changed individually, then the Holy Spirit allows us to go out and help others be changed. So we're changed as a church, we're changed as a city, we're changed as a state, we're changed as a country, we're changed as a world. The Holy Spirit comes in and sets the atmosphere and changes the culture. That's what happened in our text. In our text, Peter, old sorry Peter, old denying Peter, old hot-tempered Peter, went from 0 to 100 real quick Peter, cut your ear off real fast Peter, same Peter. All of a sudden now, Peter gets up to preach. Just a side note, Lionel, you know how many people look at me now, those that I went to college with especially, and those I went to high school with look at me and still can't believe I'm preaching. They look at me to this day and say, no, you're not preaching. What kind of scam you running? I know you ain't preaching. What kind of scam? What kind of shady operation you got going on? The way you used to act? Oh, got it. If y'all ain't going to tell about yourself, I'll tell about me. Come on, somebody. The stuff you used to do, you ain't preaching. Because they cannot believe and understand how the power of God can work within the individual. So Peter gets up and begins to preach. People already accused those filled with the Spirit of being drunk. Just a side note here. I want you to get past trying to figure out how and what you're doing, how that makes you look to other people. I want you to stop worrying about how your shout is going to affect what somebody else says about you. I want you to stop letting how your praise is going to mess you up in the eyes of somebody else. So Peter gets up immediately after these people have just accused everyone of drinking and of being drunk and of acting silly and acting crazy. Peter gets up and begins to preach. And Peter preaches, and over 3,000 people were saved that day. But what blows my mind is what happens after they join church. 3,000 people joined church, and then after they joined, the Bible said they met together every day in the temple. You mean to tell me the same folk who used to not want to be a part of anybody's church now were meeting at temple every day? That's a culture change. It's a culture change when you begin to lure people from the outside to what God's doing on the inside. And the way to change that culture is to convince them it's a whole lot more going on in here than ever's going on out there. And the more we're able to convince them of the power that resides in here, the more we're able to move them from out there to in here. So God changes the culture by allowing them to worship every day. Then here's what else he did. God changed the culture because these people saw Peter and still joined church anyhow. Imagine the press that Peter must have had. Imagine how people must have looked at Peter and said, I ain't going to any church that man belongs to. Is there anybody in here that knows you looked at somebody you knew in the past or somebody you used to know and you see them a part of something and you say, I ain't about to be a part of that, because if so-and-so is a part of it, it cannot be good. I can imagine how the people looked at Peter and said, this Peter, the same one that denied Jesus, this Peter, the same one that will cuss you out in a heartbeat, this Peter, the same one that had the temper that nobody could control. They were able to put all of that to the side because God shifted the culture and the people were able to look beyond Peter and begin to see Jesus. Church, let me tell you, stop looking at the person giving the message. Stop looking at the person delivering the word. Even if God brings your worst enemy to give you his best word, look beyond the person and begin to realize, if God's got a word for me, I don't care who's going to bring me that word, I'm going to be blessed by that word because I'm not looking at the messenger. I'm praising God for the message. But what really blows my mind about the shift in culture above the being in church all day and above Peter is simply this. Bible says the people shared everything they had with people they didn't know.
They shared everything they had with folk they never met. Shared everything they had with people who just joined the church that day. Didn't ask for a transfer letter, Marcus, from the last church you had. Didn't ask you to give your spiritual resume. Didn't say, who can I call about you? Bible said they shared, and not only did they share, this is the part that blows my mind. They sold everything they had and gave it to the church. One thing I try not to be, and I told y'all that before, one thing I don't like lying, I don't like liars. I try to tell y'all the truth, and I'm going to tell y'all the truth today. Even when I read that text now, I think that's crazy. I'm just being real with you. Imagine selling everything you got and giving it to people you don't know. I look at that and I say, man, that took some serious faith. I said, that's crazy. Wow, would I be able to do that? That's crazy. If any of y'all looking at me right now saying, no, it's not crazy, Reverend Cousin. That's what God asked us to do. I'll be right behind you as you sell your stuff today. As you sell all your stuff today, give it to Bethel. Don't give it to Reverend Cousin. Say, sell all your stuff and give it to Bethel and then come talk to me. But until you're willing to do that, baby, we're in the same boat. We're just rowing at different times. Come on, somebody. So, Bible said they sold everything they had because of a belief in the proof of the power of the Holy Spirit. In our society, not just today, but especially back then, religion was given a bad name. You had crooked Pharisees and Sadducees who were more interested in their own personal gain than they were for the advancement of the kingdom of God. You had tax collectors in collusion and cahoots with the crooked Pharisees and Sadducees, overcharging people taxes and taking extra money for themselves. You had people selling broke down turtle doves and half-baked pigeons to give as offerings to God, selling sick animals at an inflated price just to give an offering to God. You had people peddling and selling outside of the temple gates, right in front of the house of God, so much so that Jesus had to come in and flip over the temples. And with all this going on, all of a sudden, 50 days later, you've gone from a society where everybody was about themselves and not about everybody else to a society that now believe it's not about how far I can go, but how far can I help you go? It's not about what God can do for me, but it's about what I'm able to do for God. God was able to come in and change the atmosphere and shift the culture and turn some stuff around. So people stop being selfish and stop being stingy and stop worrying about themselves and begin to look out for somebody else. If there's anybody in here that knows, we might not be as bad as they were, but we sure enough need a culture shift. I wish you would stand with me right now. If you want to get us to a place where we're more giving than we are receiving, where we're more loving than we are hating, where we're able to put other people above ourselves, all we have to do is pray for the power of the Holy Spirit to shift the atmosphere. Holy Spirit's power was able to turn denial into deliverance, was able to change a culture. And the last thing the power of the Holy Spirit was able to do was to give momentum to a movement. I've been reading a lot of stuff lately. Matter of fact, y'all pray for me and pray with me. I think beginning the second Sunday in June when we go to one service, I'm going to begin a series called OUCH. The series is O-U-C-H. It's an acronym, OUCH. It stands for Overcoming Undeserved Church Hurt. It's about people that have been hurt by the church and how to overcome that church hurt. Because everybody in here knows at some point or another somebody in church has hurt you. So it's overcoming that church hurt. But what worries me nowadays is how Christianity is losing its impact. You read the statistics and you see the polls and you talk about how on all levels, especially in among denominations, how the attendance is falling off. It's not something that's just here in Ann Arbor or in Michigan. It's something that's global. How the attendance, especially in the United States, attendance is falling off. One of the things, Brother Jackson, that really blows my mind is the people have even decided now that they would rather not believe in anything than believe in God. So much so that the non-church people, the atheists and the agnostics and those who would rather believe in nothing, their numbers are rising where the numbers of those believers is dropping.
And I think the problem for that, brothers and sisters, is simply how we've begun to and continue to define Christianity. To many of us, we have allowed Christianity to be a religion. And as a religion, it's the religion of my mother. It's the religion of my father. It's the religion of my grandmother. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but I guarantee you, most of us, if not all of us in here, you're Christian right now because it's just what was handed down to you. So you saw mama going to church, so what do? You go to church. You saw grandmama going to church, so what do? You go to church. You're just modeling what you saw other people do. And somehow, some way, over time, that which started out as a movement has become a religion. But I think, brothers and sisters, that while Christianity is a religion and it's a wonderful religion, and praise God for the religion, I think some of us need to get back to our grassroots and begin to get back to that movement. When black folk wanted equality in the 60s, we called it a civil rights what? Movement. Because it was something that was important, something that we could grasp, something we could take hold to, something that we could buy into, something that even now folk gathered across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma just so they can remember that movement. I think somewhere along the line, we've allowed Christianity to be whitewashed. We've allowed Christianity to be watered down. We've allowed Christianity to move from something that used to be 7 days a week to something that only happens for 2 hours on a Sunday morning. I'm here to tell you, if you want God to do something special for you, stop treating church like it's a religion and start treating it like it's a movement. Treat it like it's something that you cannot escape, something you can't get away from, something that you cannot go away from. Begin to treat it like our early fathers and mothers did, as a movement. Church and Christianity in the beginning, it was a movement. A movement consisting of people who wanted a better life for themselves and their children. It was a movement of people who said, I'm going to step out on faith and I'm going to boldly declare I care more about you than I care about myself, and might even care more about you than you care about me. It was a movement of people that said, I will follow Jesus all the way, not worrying about how it might look to other people or how they might misunderstand. I'm here to follow Jesus. Christianity to many of us is a religion, but to how many of us can we say it's still a movement? In the text, Peter preached. 3,000 people joined church. I'm about to leave y'all alone. And those that joined began to share in a way the world had never seen. Then watch what God does next. One thing you always find in anything, a movement or religion or whatever you have, you find those that are adding to and those that are taking away from. So in the midst of all of this going on, there were people that said the only reason these folk are acting like this is because they're drunk. They have to be drunk to act like this. Peter gets up and addresses the crowd and says, no, they're not drunk. And then when it's all over, 3,000 people join church. And I'm sure the detractors said, you know what? They got their 3,000, their 4,000, their 5,000, but that's all they're going to get. They ain't getting nothing else. They were lucky that day. They got lucky that those people moved on emotion. They got lucky that those people joined on that day, but they ain't getting nobody else. Then they had to watch a day later and God brought in 10 more people. Had to watch a day later and God brought in 20 more people. Had to watch 3 days later and God brought in 100 more people. So that the 3,000, the 4,000, the 5,000 that were brought in on the day of Pentecost, that was not the end of God. That was just the beginning of God. Because God started a movement. He started a movement when Jesus came into this earth to save our souls. He started a movement when Jesus went out and ministered, beginning with his wilderness experience. He started a movement. When Jesus was able to bless those that even persecuted him, he started a movement. When Jesus was able to say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, even from a cross, he started a movement. When Jesus was able to heal blind Bartimaeus, when Jesus was able to touch the woman and help her with the issue of blood, when Jesus was able to meet that woman at the well and teach her about worship, God started a movement. God started a movement when Jesus told Lazarus, come on out of that grave. God started a movement when Jesus was able to heal those which nobody else could heal. But one thing I know about my God is simply this. And when God starts a movement, God never begins anything that God does not give further life to. God never begins anything that God doesn't make sure will ensure. God never begins anything that he will not see to its fruition. So when God begins this movement that's the church, this movement that's Christianity, this movement behind Christ Jesus, God continues just to give momentum every day, to keep it going every day, to blessing every day. But the momentum God uses comes from you and I. When we get excited about what God is doing, other folk will get excited about what God is doing. And I'm at a point in my life right now, after doing this for over 20 years, I don't care if I'm the only one shouting. I don't care if I'm the only one getting happy. I don't care if I'm the only one dancing. I'm going to get up. I'm going to celebrate. I'm going to shout. I'm going to give momentum to God's movement. God's been too good to me for me to sit on my tail. God's been too good to me for me to keep my mouth shut. God has given momentum through me to his movement. Let us stand. I want to drop this in your spirit, and we're going to go. But I want y'all to know this. I'm going to ask Reverend Connors and Reverend Milton if they do something a little different today. If you will come down to the altar rail, but stand on the outside instead of the inside, if you don't mind. Here's where we are, y'all. Here's where we are. I'm a realist. I'm not going to come and ask you to do something for me if every time you've asked me to do something for you, I've been unwilling. If Sister Barry comes to me and says, Reverend, can you help me? I need to ride to the grocery store. And I say, no, I ain't got time. And she asks me because her car's down. And I say, I ain't got time. I ain't got time. And then gets her car back. Then I lose my car. I'm not going to go to Sister Barry and ask her for a ride. I'm pretty certain what the answer is going to be. Although Sister Barry's a sweetheart, she'd probably say yes anyhow. So why then? I know it's God, I know. But why do we go to God, ask God to do all this stuff for us, and we ain't really been willing to do much of nothing for God? You know, I had to, with my own children the other day, with my own children, Jesus, y'all pray for me. If I ask you to do something, I don't need a discourse as to why you don't want to do it. If I ask you to do something, it's either going to be, okay, Daddy, I'm going to do it, or I'm not going to do it. And if you say no, the consequences are yours to deal with. I don't need a discourse. I don't need a dissertation. I don't need us to have a dialogue about it. I don't need you to tell me why I don't want it. I ain't ask you all that. I asked you to do this. Either you're going to do it or you're not. Why then do we do God like that when we don't want other people doing it to us? God says do this. Well, God, I don't know. God says tithe. Well, God, I don't know. I ain't got no money. The reason you ain't got no money is you ain't learned how to manage the bit you've got right now. Come on, somebody. God, I ain't got no money for you. No, but you got money for Macy's. God, I ain't got no money for you. No, but you got money to eat out at Bravo. Come on, somebody. I've come to understand if I want God to give momentum to the movements in my life, then I must be willing to give momentum, help give momentum to the movement that is God's movement, that is furthering the gospel of Christ Jesus, and that is testifying to the power of the Holy Spirit. And maybe the reason you don't have the movement in your stuff right now that you want is because you know deep down inside you have not given God the movement he asked for. But when you give God the momentum in your movement, in his movement that he's asking for, he'll make momentum and movement in yours. But you've got to be willing to give God your best. So right now, brothers and sisters, here's where we are. If there's anybody under the sound of my voice, three things, that's looking for a church home, I'd like you to come down right now. We'd love to have you be a part of what God is doing here. If there are any persons under the sound of my voice that desire to receive the salvation, the same salvation Peter preached about that day, I ask that you would come down right now. Or if there's anybody that just